When we were discussing about the topic, practical topic, it was me who suggested to have a practical talk on prayer. The reason behind is to make our EU students prayerful students. So that has been my I was sharing, and then it came to me to take this session, and I believe that all of us will be blessed through this practical session on prayer. This will be, you may not be aware of the session. This is a prayer that we're going to have a talk now. Right. Okay. Right. So I'm there. So nice. Let's look to God in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we commit this power supply, internet connectivity, everything, network, everything into your throne of grace. And also we pray and commit each one of us in your hands that we will all be able to concentrate, O Lord, to learn why prayer is necessary and how to pray and what to pray, when to pray. All these things are very, very important for us and help us to really understand and make each one of us to be prayerful people, O Lord, to be very effective in our prayer life. Thank you so much for committing this time into your throne of grace. In Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Right. So how many of, I'm sure all of us pray, and we pray in the morning, we pray in the night, we pray in the daytime, evening, we pray all the time. So everyone prays. So you may be thinking, hey, we all pray every day, and what is the need to have a session on prayer? So I think this is very, very important to learn how to pray, you know. And what is the need for us to pray? It's very important for all of us to learn this. So maybe I will share the screen. Yeah. Screen visible?
Yes, yes, uncle.
All right. Thank you. All right, so here we go. Fine. There's this problem of screen sharing. We don't see each other, but as we have been encouraging all of us to, you know, to, yes, very good. Now I think I'm visible. Right, introduction, here we see prayer very much a part and parcel of Christian life. So we all pray because we believe in prayer, and prayer is, you know, part of our life. We pray all the time. So, but we need to also know why, what is prayer, and why should we pray, and how should we pray? You know, that is something very interesting. How should we pray, and when to pray, different ways of prayer, and how can our prayers be effective? So let us see one by one And let us try to be attentive, and so that this session will be some way be helpful for all of us to be effective in our prayer life. So prayer is, if I ask what is prayer, and I'm sure all of you will have something to say, you know. All right, so okay, Sangha, Tan Sangha, Santia, what is your understanding? How do you, if somebody asks you what is prayer, how will you answer?
It's how I communicate to God.
Wow, very good. How I communicate to God, how I talk to God, you know, talking to God, you know, in a personal way, or talking to God in a corporate way or different ways. Yes, thank you so much. Right. It is an expression of our dependence on God, our inability and our inadequacy. You see, expressing, you know, our limitations, our inability, our weaknesses, bringing to God. So very interesting. Why expressing to God? Who is God then? Why do we need to express our dependency or our inability, our limitations? What is the need to bring that to God? And who is God? As Psalm 121 clearly says, oh, I look up to the mountain. Where do I my help come from? Not from the mountain, not from the hills, but comes from the creator of heaven and earth, right? So he is all-powerful. He is all omnipotent, omniscient, omnipresent. He is almighty. And so when we pray, all his God's power, authority, strength is made available in our prayer. When we go to him and pray, you see? So his authority, his presence, omnipresence, omniscient, that is being available in our prayer. Yes, so prayer is, anytime. You know, space has nothing to do with that, nothing to stop us. We can pray anytime, anywhere. You see, any place, anywhere, anytime. What an opportunity, right? So when you remain in God, when we are united in God, and we will talk more on that, when we are one with God, then prayer and our relationship can never, with God, can never be separated. When I say I believe in God, I remain in God, then our prayer becomes automatic. We depend fully in God. See? And so prayer and God, we remain in God, and prayer can never be separated. It is always together. So prayer is the key to victorious Christian life. Why people succumbs to temptation? Why people succumb to temptation? Why we fall into temptation? You know, why we live a defeated life? Why we live a defeated life? Why always going through failures and, you know, defeated life? Because our prayer life is weak. So prayer, the key to victorious life. If I fail to spend 2 hours in the morning, the devil gets victory. See, the devil gets victory throughout the day Martin Luther said, you see, if I fail to spend 2 hours in the morning, the devil gets victory throughout the day. Martin Luther. And then he who prays sins not, and he who sins prays not. Right? It's very interesting, right? So when we pray, we, you know, sin less, or we sin not. We do not sin when we are sincere in prayer, fervent in prayer. But when a person who keeps committing sin, that means there is no prayer in that person's life, right? Okay, so now we see here, why should we pray? All right, we know a little bit about what is prayer, and so now let's see. You know, in that what is prayer, our God who is, you see, sovereign and omniscient and omnipotent, as we were told, King of kings and Lord of lords, you see, he reigns forever and if ever willing to listen to your prayer and my prayer. He's the King of kings, Lord of lords, and he's everything, Almighty God, yet, or creator of everything, yet he is ever willing to listen to your prayer and my prayer. Is not that amazing? And so then why should we pray? All right. Jesus set an example. Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus himself is God. He is God. He himself is God, right? Then, no, he himself is God. And then how much Jesus' life is being, how he demonstrated his prayer life, fully dependent, depending on the Father who sent him to fulfill the will of the Father. You know, so he is fully in communion with his Father, praying. You see, miracle that he performs, he will go there to isolated place and he will pray. Anything, everything is in close communion with his Father, right? His life, his ministry is full of prayer. See, he himself is God. Jesus himself is God, the Son of God. He himself is God. And how much is he praying? He was praying all the time. And then you and I, so insignificant, you and I, you know, we are nothing, in fact. So you and I, how much you and I need to pray more? See, Jesus himself, Son of God, and how much he was praying, and how much you and I, as staff, as EU leaders, as leader of your family members, as, you know, as a discipleship, DTC participants, how much we need to pray, how much more we need to pray. Yes, so as we all know, as I was saying a little bit about the life of Jesus, before he began his ministry, we all know he was fasting and praying for 40 days and 40 nights, right? As we see in Matthew. I'm not going to, you know, read the scripture passages. And when he started his ministry, you know, the healing crusade was happening, and that too, the healing crusade was happening only when? 1 minute. I think I should. One should be. Right. Okay. So, before he began his ministry, he fasted praying 40 days and 40 nights. And when he started his ministry, we all know the healing crusade started taking place only after the sun sets, as we know in Mark chapter 1. And what did he do? So tired. And then he went early in the morning to the isolated place to pray, right? That we all know. And then, you know, what happened after Jesus? He said, his disciples were tired of reporting what all God had done through the disciples. And they were busy and they were not having even time to eat. And what did Jesus do? Jesus was suggesting them, why don't we go to the isolated place to rest, you know, to have a relaxing time or maybe some kind of retreat, right? So that way they went. But then there they were so tired and they went to pray. They were so tired, and Jesus was suggesting, let's go to the isolated place. And then, what is happening? All right, so many things are happening here. All right. So that way, you know, there, after feeding the 15,000, 20,000, possibly 5,000, and then, they said they were tired. And he kept on teaching and feeding the 5,000. And what happened after that? We all know. He went to the mountain, again, mountain top, higher, and there he began to pray, right? So what I'm trying to say is, see, we have the tendency to come up with an excuse that, I'm tired, God knows, and let me just relax, you see? So whereas Jesus, he was totally tired, yet he set aside giving topmost priority to go and pray, right? So, and then we see that, you know, to appoint his disciples, followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, he was spending whole night, early morning, late night praying, and then whole night praying. That we could see in the life of Jesus in Luke chapter 6, verse 12. And then when Jesus was, you know, praying in the Garden of Gethsemane, even he was so going through the most painful time, not suffering, you know, not suffering with the pain or not not hitting him and then, you know, stripping him, not those pain. He was not afraid of those pains, but he was in agony. He was going through in deep sorrow because he had to take the sins of this mankind, for that his Father in heaven will, you know, feel he will have to leave Jesus. And that's what he said, why have you forsaken me? Why have you forsaken me? That is what Jesus was going through, very, very inexpressible pain, because his Father, he was saying, why have you forsaken me? That was what Jesus did not want to go through. And so that way, and even that time, how much, you know, Jesus was going through and in his prayer. I mean, we know that he started his ministry, or before he started his ministry, he started with prayer, fasting, and he ended his ministry on the cross. And he ended with prayer, forgive them. You see, he left all that, physical suffering and pain, and he was concerned about the person, you know, standing, or the person who were killing or persecuting him, praying concern for them and for their souls, right? So yes, so prayer is like being plugged to the power source. You see, we all, you know, we are fully into gadgets, right? Laptop and, you know, and phone, and we always plugged in. We search for the plug to plug into the socket, you see. So without getting plugged into the socket, nothing, no power will come when the battery finishes, right? So something like that, our prayer life, we may be praying so hard, but if your heart and my heart is not in tune with God, that will not make sense. So prayer is like, you know, you plugged in to the power source, plugged in tune with your relationship with the Lord. Without the proper relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, no matter how much we pray, doesn't work. No matter how much we pray, doesn't work. All right, here it is very important. Shall we all unmute ourselves and read the last, you know, the bolded line? Shall we all read together? One.
More prayer.
One, more two, power. Together. One, two, three.
More prayer.
Thank you. So I'm sure you all of us agree with this, right? More prayer, more power. You go come to the fellowship when there is less prayer. Oh, you are afraid. You want to hide at the back. You know, you are covering yourself, trying to avoid. If Zolboi asks you to pray, if Zolboi asks you to share something, you try to avoid because your personal prayer is so weak and nothing to pray, nothing to share, right? So, but when your prayer life is strong, then you are always looking for an opportunity. You want to go to the front. You want to go to and sit in the front. Or you are looking for an opportunity that pastor will give you an opportunity. Ready. Power. Excitement. Right? But when there is no prayer, oh, you become so weak. Satan doesn't care about you. But Satan start fretting, getting threatened when we start praying, right? All right. So why should we pray? We are praying following, you know, the life of Jesus. How important it is, praying. How to pray then? You know, this is very interesting again. Jesus' disciples, they had been seeing Jesus praying, right? They had been seeing Jesus going to the isolated and pray. And then after the prayer, miracle happens. And Jesus will be always praying. They see the life of Jesus being prayerful. So they started to ask Jesus, Lord, teach us how to pray. We also want to be prayerful people. We also want to be effective in our prayer life. But we don't know how to pray. You teach us how to pray, right? You teach us how to pray. And so Jesus was teaching them, as we all know, the Lord's Prayer. So he was teaching them. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from all evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Right? So, very interesting. Here in these seven petitions, seven petitions. You just let's listen carefully. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive them those who trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation. So there are seven petitions over here, and only one is for the material needs. So it is so important. And there is a need to check the content of our everyday prayer. Is this making sense? It is so important for us to check the content of our everyday prayer. How is our prayer? And how Jesus was teaching his disciples, and he was teaching you and I how to pray. Here, only one in seven petitions, only one is for the material needs. What about our prayer? All the other petitions were for related to eternal, related to relationship and intercession, surrendering to God's sovereignty. So it is so important for us to check how is the content of our prayer every day or every time, right? There is a tendency in our prayer, praying always, you know, for our material needs, I think. Swami,
am I audible?
Yes, uncle.
Okay.
So.
One minute, something is going wrong. My battery is not charging.
Hello?
Yes, uncle.
1 minute, I need somebody's help. It's on, they are able to hear. But the screen is gone. All right. So
fine. So okay. Right. Sorry, some problem over here. So now, where are we? So, yes, we are concerned in most cases about our material needs, right? We pray for our studies, we pray for our, now Christmas is coming, we pray for our dress, Christmas dress, and we pray for the, you know, new mobiles and then for our future, and you know, everything just around me and myself and me and my family, you see. But you know, Jesus was asking us to pray for our daily needs, give us this day our daily bread, right? Daily bread. But in most cases, we are praying not only the daily bread, but we pray for not only our needs, but we pray for our wants. For our ones. So this is what we have, Jesus has taught us. So it is so important to check the content of our prayer every day that we pray. All right.
Recording in progress.
So, yes, next that we have is right. All right. So when we pray, it is so important for us.
Our prayer should be, you know, using the abbreviation of ACTS, that is ACTS. You know, that is first is adoration, worshiping. When we sit pray, we worship Him. And then in the process of our worshiping Him, we confess our sins, the sin, known sin, unknown sin, deliberate sin, undeliberate sins. We need to confess our sins with contrite heart. And then we, with confessing and at the same time, thanksgiving, giving thanks to Him for all the good things that He has done in our lives, all the blessings that we receive from God. So thanksgiving. And then, you know, submission, submitting for
meeting everything into God's hand. So submitting everything into God's hand. So I think, so now this is helping us how to pray, right? Something we are learning, I believe. Okay, so next we go to right. Fine. We see like, and when and how much we should pray, right? How and how much to pray. That is, pray without ceasing. So sorry. Yeah. See, like when we look at the life of, when we read First Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17, Paul was encouraging to the believers, pray without ceasing, non-stop. Pray without ceasing, which is very, very important. Before that, when we look at the life of Daniel, how busy, such a, holding such a big, great responsibility in the palace serving the king. And then he disciplined himself, praying 3 times in a day. Oh, his prayer is not just an ordinary prayer, but sincere prayer, disciplining himself, which is so important. And David, who was busier than King David, in his time? As a king, so busy, such a powerful king, so busy. But then he had definite prayer time daily. Psalm 51:17, that we see is Psalm 51:17. He had definite time for prayer, no matter how busy he was. What about us? What about us? When we have seen the life of Jesus, no matter how busy, how tired, how hungry, how exhausted he was, he set aside the isolated place, or, all alone, sending the disciples all alone, praying. Daniel's life, we could see prayerfulness. David, prayerfulness. We see the life of Nehemiah, right? He began to sit and cry and fast and pray. And then after several months only, he appeared before the king, right? And then because of his disciplined, powerful prayer, the miracle took place, which was impossible. In human point of view, in human strength, it was impossible to rebuild the broken wall of Jerusalem. In 52 days, it was completed miraculously because of the power of prayer. Power of prayer. So we need to pray without ceasing. Praying for everything. Any good things that we see, praise God. Or anything which has come unexpected, just be on knees and pray. And then Paul Yanggicho, pastor of the biggest church, I don't know, still the biggest, or we know pastor of the biggest church, Paul Yanggicho, he said, the one who does not pray for at least an hour is not a believer. You see, and one who does not pray for at least 2 hours is not a servant of God. Friends, our dear EU friends and campers, how is our prayer? How is our prayer life? Which is very, very important. I would like to encourage and challenge each one of us. How much is your prayer time? So I would like to encourage all of us to pray more so that your life and my life will be exciting, powerful, right? So, all right, we pray. I don't know how much time, if Tamsanga can give me a warning before 5 minutes, right? There are different ways of prayer. Let's keep on praying in the spirit with all kinds of prayers. Praying. Can someone read Ephesians 6:18? Ephesians 6:18. You will get mark for that.
I will read.
Okay.
Ephesians 6:18. And pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the saints.
Praying all the time. Yes, so our leaders can take note of that person from which group. Thank you. And so different ways of prayer which may be adopted by you. Friends, IU groups, individual prayer. I would like to emphasize individual prayer. Individual prayer, very, very important. You know, individual prayer. You may be attending the fellowship. You may be attending the, you know, group prayer meeting and, you know, college prayer meeting and things like that. Very good. But what about your individual personal prayer life? That is very, very important. See, like when we are in a group and when the opportunity is given for open sharing, personal prayer, open sharing, personal needs, we pray for common things and then it's time for personal prayer sharing. In most cases, you know, members become pin drop silence. Hardly anyone feels the need of sharing prayer points. Why? That is the result of your prayerlessness. That is the result of your prayerlessness. Your individual prayer is very weak. And that's why you don't feel the need of prayer. You know, friends, when you are praying, when your prayer life, personal prayer life is strong, there's so much need to pray and you don't feel that praying alone is not enough. You feel you are looking for an opportunity where friends will come and you are willing to share, as the scripture says in James chapter 5, the prayer of righteous people have powerful effect. So praying alone is not enough. You know, Jesus was praying in a garden of Gethsemane. He expected John, Peter, James to pray along with him because he was finding very, very difficult to pray alone. So if your individual prayer life is strong, then when you come for a group prayer, you will be the first person to share. Oh, you know, this is an opportunity. Let me share. Individual prayer is very, very important and very effective and very influential and contagious. When your prayer life is strong, then your life becomes so infectious, contagious, influential. Thank you. And what about when was the last time that you had a fasting prayer? When was the last time you had a fasting prayer? This is very, very important. I would like to encourage each one of you. I'm sure EU students, campers of Discipleship Training Camp, I want you and I want to encourage you to fast and pray. When you fast and pray, that shows that you are serious about what you are praying. You feel strongly convicted that, oh, this prayer concern is so important, and how can I enjoy eating like everyone is enjoying eating when my prayer is not answered, when this need is not answered, when there is so much of problem like this, and when ministry is not growing, how can I keep quiet and enjoy eating like anyone is doing eating? You know, when Prophet Samuel, he was asking Jesse, the father of David, where is David? Is there anyone left? Is there anyone left? Any brother left? Any son left? Yes, there is still one. He is in the jungle. He's in the forest taking care of my sheep. He said, you bring him until and unless he reaches home. Oh, I will not sit. That shows that his seriousness. He is not willing to eat. He is not willing to sit even till he comes. Friends, until and unless my prayer is answered, I will not eat. See, that shows you are serious about what you are praying. So I would like to encourage each one of us, if you are serious about your prayer life, about the prayer that the concern that you are praying, fast and pray. Very, very important. It is so good. One thing I would like to encourage each one of you, my dear campers and my dear EU friends. What keeps me excited, what keeps me going till today is my discipline, fasting, prayer. I'm not boasting. I'm not blowing my own trumpet. I'm just sharing this to encourage you. You may be thinking that, oh, he's a staff worker for 15 years. That is why he is doing this. Oh, by the time I reach his age, I will also do the same like him. But what about his life when he was in the first year or second year or third year or fourth year like me? My dear friends, I started disciplining my fasting prayer life once in a week when I was in my first year in my college days. And that keeps me to be what I am today. Though I'm good for nothing person, but how God blesses me and use me thus far is my discipline, fasting, prayer life. So I would like to encourage each one of you as well. If you're serious, if you really want God to use you and bless you, discipline to receive God's blessing from the Lord is this reciprocal. He will bless you, but we will also need to do our part. All right. So different ways of prayer and prayer walk. You know, coordinator Jonah and myself, early in the morning, we get up and go for prayer walk, which is also very, very good. And especially EU students, hostelers, wherever you are, you know, go for prayer walk, which is, I would like to encourage all of you, prayer walk. Where there is no fellowship happening, where there is no ministry in the campus, go around the campus claiming in the name of Jesus, claiming the name of Jesus, that fellowship will start happening in that campus, in that school campus, college campus. All right. And whole night prayer, you know, whole night prayer is also, again, very, very important. Half night prayer, it is when the situation becomes normal. I would like to encourage, you know, in the weekdays, spend half night prayer, praying for other students, praying for other friends who do not know the Lord, rises before the sun, after the sun sets, you see, and corporate prayer. So these are different ways of prayers, but most importantly, I would like to encourage each one of you to pray. Personal prayer life in the first place. How can our prayer... James chapter 5, verse 16. The prayer of righteous people has powerful effect. Your prayer will be effective and will have powerful effect if you live a righteous life. If you live a righteous life, if you your prayer or if your life is strong in your relationship with the Lord, if you remain in me and my words remain in you, then you ask for anything, I will do it. Jesus says in John chapter 15, verse 7, right? So James is telling right relationship with God. The prayer of righteous people has powerful effect. If you are in a relationship, if you are, you know, into all these worldly things and things and you know, watching pornography and then smoking, which is giving you guilty conscience, and drinking and, you know, chewing tobacco and all that. If you do, your relationship is getting affected. And even if you pray with that, you know, you will, your prayer will not be, your prayer will not be heard by God. Why we, how do we know that? When we see in Isaiah chapter 59, verse 1 and 2, there says, oh, the Lord's hand is long enough. The Lord's father's ears, the Lord's ears are wide open, and hands are long enough to save you. Ears are wide open to hear your prayer. But because of your sin, because of your iniquities, God doesn't hear our prayer. It doesn't go beyond the ceiling because of the sin, right? So, but friends, in 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, it says, if you confess your sins, he is faithful and just. If we confess, because of our sins, he cannot hear our prayer. So there we have read before, we have mentioned that in your worship, confessing your sin is very, very important. Confessing your sin. Coming to God with contrite heart. Confess your sins, then he is faithful and just, and he will forgive. And with that, confessing our sins, all right, can someone quickly read? Okay, again, next point. Can someone quickly read 1 John chapter 3, verse 22 and 20? Right. Oh, can you hear me?
Yes, uncle.
Am I audible?
Yes, uncle, you are audible.
Hey, and then what about, is someone reading 1 John chapter 3, verse 22 and 23?
Yes, brother, uncle, let me read it. 1 John chapter 3, verse, what was it again? Can you please repeat it?
22 and 23 is there in the screen sharing, yeah.
22. I can't see your screen sharing. Okay, let me read the Holy Word of God. And receive from him anything we ask, because we keep his commands and do what pleases him. And this is his command, to believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and to love on one another as he commands us.
Right. Here, yes. Very good. Thank you. Thank you, MC. Right. So here, if our conscience does not condemn us anymore, we have courage in God's presence. We receive from him whatever we ask because we obey his commands and do what pleases him. So now, here it is clearly says that 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, there clearly says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just, he will forgive all our sins and, you know, unrighteousness. And so when we confess our sins, then our conscience is clear. We have set right with God. Our heart doesn't condemn us anymore because we have confessed our sins. He has heard our prayers and he has forgiven our sins. And when we ask with that genuine confession of our sins and we pray and submit that into God's hand, he hears our prayers. Anything that we ask, he answers. He hears and answers. Right. Okay. And another thing, see, set all others' relationships right. You know, oh, I have been praying so much, but nothing is happening. I prayed and prayed, and then I don't see any answer. I'm not able to see any answer. Why? Again, here it is very important. You know, Jesus was telling, right? Jesus was telling, if your gift to the altar and there remember that your brother has done something against, leave your gift there before the altar and go your way. First be reconciled and then come and offer your gift, right? That means if there is any grudges, if there is anything which you are not happy or you are having that unforgiving mind, unforgiving heart on somebody, friends, with that unforgiving heart on someone, on you. Yeah, right. So it is, Jesus was first set right, and pray. And if you are not able to go and meet, make phone call. Oh, I didn't mean, I think you are hurt. I'm so sorry. I didn't mean to do that, but I have hurt you. I have offended you. I'm so sorry, brother. Please forgive me. Sister, please forgive me. Very, very important. Whether he forgives or not, whether she forgives or not, that is not your responsibility. Your responsibility, my responsibility, is to put conscious effort and call, oh, I'm sorry, brother. I got to know from my friend that you are hurt and offended because of what I said that day. I'm so sorry. Please forgive me. You see? That is very good. That is how we should be reconciling. And with that reconciliation, you sit right with God and pray, and then God hears. Otherwise, you may say, oh, why is not hearing? Why? Because you have not sat right with God and with a person. And do not be anxious for anything, Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. You know, I just want to help you this one again. Now, you are so disturbed, you are so restless, and you are unable to take any decision. And if you take decision in your anxiousness or anxiety, if you take decision, that can be a wrong decision. So what should you do? Paul was telling to the believers in Philippi, do not be anxious for anything. Also now. But in everything, you know, submit to God. So when you are anxious and when you are disturbed, that means there is no peace of mind. The peace of God is not there in you. So in a time like that, you continue to pray and pray. Do not take any decision. Pray and pray and pray. Again, you pray until you get that, you know, until and unless you get the peace of mind from the Lord. Don't take decision. Don't jump in to react. Just pray. I had experienced that, you know. I was so disturbed and I was so angry. It was that you, a small boy, behaving like this. You know, I was so disturbed and I have every right to, you know, give him back or give her back like that. But then I was praying. I was thinking, oh, yes, with this struggle, that anxiousness, anxiety that I'm going through, God is going to teach me a lesson. So I was praying. And then slowly I started, you know, getting the peace from the Lord. Peace that passes all understanding. You see, understanding that comes. Now I realize that when I was angry and when I was anxious, I was 100% correct. But when the Lord starts speaking to me that passes all understanding, I realizing that there is a mistake from my side. I started realizing that there is a, you know, deep down, this problem is there within me. And then I began to confess and then ask God to set me right. You see? So that is Paul. That's why Paul was saying, do not be anxious for anything. If there is anxiousness, hey, pray. That God takes that away and give you understanding and you go into the right decision. Right. So, yes, as I have mentioned, John chapter 15, verse 7, and then 1 John chapter 5, 16, 17, that is also when you confess your sins, you go to God with courage and boldness. Because there is no sin in you, and with that sinless approach, attitude, God hears your prayer, right? Okay, so now we are coming to the last part. I think time is almost up. So here, Solomon's prayer also very, very important that we see. Selfless prayer. He was also praying. No any self-interest, but selfless prayer that we see. Friends, practical tips, some tips I would like to suggest also. Wandering minds. We pray, we say we will pray, but we will pray for only 2-3 points for so many minutes. One mind is wandering. I'm praying, but you know, mine is going here and there, not concentrating. Let us not wander our minds. But to avoid that wandering minds, it is always good to write it down, the points that you are going to pray, so that that will help you not to wander your minds going here and there. And at the same time, when your mind is wandering, it is always good to go to the, you know, isolated place or choose a place where you can, you know, pray with voice. That also helps in, you know, that also helps in, you know what, concentration, praying with concentration. And then drowsiness. Again, this is as Lute was telling in the morning, when is the best time for your quiet time? He was giving her suggestion. Morning time is the best time. You know, I would like to encourage each one of you. Some of you may say, oh, I do in the quiet, my quiet time or my prayer time in the night. Oh, what night? Night to your whole day since morning, your mind is full of all tired. You are distracted. You are all being a whole day, all out, disturbed and restless and tired. And nighttime praying, that is obvious that you will go to sleep. Or your prayer will never be fresh. And for example, if you are studying in a college, like St. Xavier's College, Kolkata, where they have, you know, college at 6 a.m. in the morning, for them, there is a challenge to do their quiet time or prayer time in the morning. Because they have to go at up early morning and catch bus and travel. But for our normal life people like us, please do your quiet time. Don't keep in the daytime, don't keep in the nighttime. Morning, The best time when your mind is fresh. When your mind is fresh. That's what Jesus is saying. First me. First me includes that also. Of course, there are certain, exceptional case where emergency, that is different thing. But normally, keep in the morning when your mind is fresh. Everything is fresh. Fresh. All right. So that will help you to be to avoid drowsiness, laziness. You know, laziness is something again. Oh, you know, when you are, we recognize two types of sleeps. Okay, one is a sleep to exhaustion and tiredness. You work hard, and then you get tired, and then you go off to sleep. But another sleep is you sleep for 6 hours or 6.5 hours or sometimes 7 hours, and you still feel sleepy. You still feel sleepy. That means that is laziness, right? This is laziness. Proverbs 20 verse 13 says, do not love sleep. Do not love sleep. It is number. So let's fight against it. That is very, very important. And friends, one last point that I would like to mention here is busyness. Busyness. We keep ourselves so busy. No time for quiet time. No time for prayer. No time for fellowship. No time. Oh, construction work is going on. We are constructing our house and we want to finish our construction work before Christmas. So no time to pray. No time. It's all foolish. It's foolish coming up with that kind of excuses. Friends, campers, EU leaders, many a time we get engrossed, we get drowned with his blessings. And we forget and neglect the source. He blesses you and I with energy, with strength, with everything. He blesses us with everything. And we are carried away with his blessings and forgetting and neglecting. The source, God, he will be very upset. So I would like to encourage each one of us to keep this quiet time in the topmost priority without compromising. He will be very upset. You learned quiet time so nicely, and you will be giving a commitment at the end and say, I am going to do my quiet time every day. How many students who have attended the SLTC and DTC and CMTC and NMTC, they attend all the camps. Where are they? Are they really doing their quiet time today? God blesses them so much, and they are carried away with God's blessing and neglecting God, the source, forgetting God. God is very upset. So I would like to make a humble appeal to all the campers, all DTC campers. Please, you are going to make commitment at the end, saying that, please pray for me that I have made up my mind to do my quiet time. Let us stick to the quiet time that we have made. We will be making commitment. And that is where God is going to use you. That is where God is going to bless you in abundance through your life. Last night I was mentioning, God is interested in your life. God wants to bless you and use you to bring change and transformation in a family, in a church, in a society, in the state at large. So may God bless each one of us as God's children. Prayer. Is the communication to with our loving Father, who is ever willing to hear our prayers. It is the greatest privilege we have been given. This spending time with him is a wonderful, powerful privilege which God has given us. So this is the power to demolish all strongholds, your weaknesses, your inferiority complex, your low self-esteem, and all your area of weaknesses. Prayer is going to demolish everything. Thank you so much. So for victorious and effective Christian lives, right prayerful lives is the only godly solution. So may God bless each one of us, and let us be prayerful students, prayerful EU students. May God bless each one of us. Thank you.